Our scripture reading for today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 2, the first 11 verses. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and to me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were six stone water jars for the Jewish rite of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed him. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, open our hearts and minds this day. Create in each of us a clean heart and put a right spirit in us, now and always. Amen. So this is the first of six sermons that I'm going to do on the healing, on miracles of Jesus. I think they all have to do with healing, but it's definitely the miracles of Jesus. And so this morning, since it is Communion Sunday, and it's always Communion Sunday here in this service, we're going to start with water into wine, and I'm just going to jump right in. In this scripture today, in this miracle of turning water into wine, in verse 11, we read, What Jesus did in Cana of Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. Now, according to this passage, this was the first miracle of Jesus. And I find that interesting. Why would this be the miracle that Jesus chose to lead with? I can think of other miracles that Jesus did that had far more reaching effects than running out of wine at a wedding. Jesus made the blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk. He even brought people back to life. And yet he decided it was not only significant to turn water into wine, it was important enough to make this his first miracle. Now maybe I'm overthinking this providing wine in a wedding celebration, but to me, it's just not a big deal. I mean, it wasn't as if the caterers forgot to show up, or that someone broke in and stole all the wine. It wasn't as if there was a disaster in the kitchen and all the wine got ruined, or that the grape harvest was infested and no wine could be made. There's no doubt that the act of turning water into wine is miraculous, but was the reason for the miracle really necessary? Think of the miracles that Jesus did do. He cleansed lepers. He cured those with epilepsy. He released demons from people who were possessed. He relieved those who suffered from crippling backs and dropsy and blood disorders. And all of that began with making sure there was enough wine at a party. I am not questioning Jesus' motives or his wisdom, but I do want to understand the deeper meaning of this miracle. Jesus is the Son of God and our Savior, and his wisdom and his power and his love, they are unsurpassed. Jesus could calm a raging storm using just his words. He could walk on water. He could feed 5,000 people with just a small portion of bread and fish. He could empower his disciples to catch so many fish that their nets broke. He could instantly reattach a servant's ear, and he could find tax money in a fish's mouth. So since turning water into wine is in this list of all the miraculous things that Jesus did, I think it's important that we look at this miracle and see what Jesus is trying to teach us. From this story, we learn that Christ takes care of our every need. We understand that he is not only our Savior, but we have with him his living presence. And we learn the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. So let's take those sentences apart one by one. First, we learn that Jesus takes care of our every need. If the first miracle had been one of healing, it would have meant a lot to those that bore witness to the event, and it would have meant a whole lot to the one being healed. But this miracle took place in a big community celebration, so it affected an entire population. The bride and the groom and their families were all equally changed by this miracle. When Jesus turned water into wine, he saved families from embarrassment and humiliation. Being a good host, showing true hospitality, was of the utmost importance during this time in history. And that's not a big shock, because being hospitable is still important to us today. Would you ever invite people to dinner and then have not enough food? We would never do that. Do you invite people into your home and then do nothing to care for them? When people come over, are they expected to bring all their own provisions? Of course not. When someone comes to our homes, we go out of our way to make sure that the place is clean, that it's inviting, and that we have more than enough food on hand. My mother taught me always to make enough at dinner time so that if anyone stopped by at that hour, you could invite them in to stay, because there would always be enough food. And if you ever want to stop by our house, you should first wait till we buy one and I get the family up here. But if you ever want to stop by our house at dinner time, there will always be enough food and we will invite you to stay. I just ask that don't all come on the same day. In my grandmother's day in Scotland, it was a social convention to offer someone tea when they came to your house. My grandmother would make tea all day long. She would boil the water in the kettle, and she would reboil it every half hour. So if someone ever stopped by, they never said, "Oh, I can't wait for a cup of tea." It was always ready to go. As human beings, it is important for us to be gracious to our friends and our guests, and it was even more so in the time of Jesus. To run out of wine at a wedding feast would have been the height of bad manners. So much so, the families of the bride and groom would have been disgraced by the entire community, shunned and ridiculed from that point forward. Jesus did not turn water into wine to reinvigorate a party. He performed this miracle to help everyday people in need, and in doing so took care of families in need, took care of a community. No condemnation on the part of Jesus, no judgment, no punishment, just an opportunity in someone's home to show sympathy and kindness and understanding. And by performing this miracle at a wedding feast, Jesus restored dignity. Now, second in this miracle, the importance of Christ is his living presence in our midst. Jesus is with us each day, dealing with the issues that life throws at us at any given moment. It is a great comfort for me to know that is in those everyday moments, Christ is by my side. Now, we all know that in the moments of trouble and fear, we feel God's presence, and God is first and foremost in our thoughts. And there are times when we rely greatly on prayer and scripture to guide and lead us. In times of great decision, we can read from Romans, and we know that all things for God works for good for those who love him and have been called according to his purpose. In times of illness, we can rely on the fact that the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. In times of grief, we can rely on, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." In times of tragedy, we can say, "I can do all things through him who gives me strength." And just as it is important to cling to God in these moments, it is also important to understand that the living Christ is right here in the everyday living of our lives. This miracle took place at a party, a reception to celebrate the coming together of two people in marriage. I don't think there's a person here who has never been to a wedding reception. It's what we do. Jesus was doing what we all do, celebrating at a wedding, and it was here that he came to the need of two people, particularly, who need help. He demonstrated his presence to guide, his example to lead, and his love to support. And in the routines of daily living, we see a Christ that is always by our side. We can do that too. Sometimes the best way that we can love one another is simply to be with another person, to offer them our presence. We don't have to come to the rescue. We don't have to do something fabulous and miraculous. We can illustrate Christ in our lives by being there, by being kind, by being patient, by listening, by working behind the scenes, by doing what we need to do to please God. And doing all of this simply by giving a presence to other human beings. Christ is with us during those raging storms in our lives, and Christ is also with us during the quiet routines of life. And it is in both that he gives to us that living presence that dwells in our hearts. Now, the final thing we learn from this story is that Christ gives to us that free gift of grace. Now, for this, I want to go back to verse 6. Now, standing there were six stone water jars, each holding 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said, "Fill the jars with water," and they filled them to the brim. When the steward tasted the water had become wine, he said to the groom, "Everyone saves the good wine till serves it first so that they give the bad wine when everyone's drunk, but you didn't do that. You're doing the good wine now." So in order to look at God's grace, let's look at the actual miracle part of this lesson. So there were six stone jars, each holding between 20 to 30 gallons. And we know they were 30 gallons because they filled them to the brim. So 30 gallons of water in a jar, six jars. That's 180 gallons of wine. I could fill Marcy's Honda Civic almost 14 times with that amount of liquid. 180 gallons. Now, I went to Google and I typed in how many bottles of wine in a gallon. And a standard 750 milliliter bottle of wine is 1/5 of a gallon. So it takes 5 bottles to earn a gallon. And there was 180 gallons, that's 900 bottles of wine. What kind of party was this? If you ever have a party and you have 900 bottles of wine on hand, please invite me. I have to know what that kind of party looks like. That's a lot of wine, 900 bottles of wine. Why? Why did Jesus have to go to that much? There's no way after a week of celebration that they needed 900 more bottles of wine than what they started with. Why the abundance? Well, I'll tell you the abundance, but I have to read a quote. I don't like to miss quotes, and I like to come out, so this is what you get. So Jill Duffield, who's the editor of Presbyterian Outlook, at least she was when I looked up this quote, in an article where she quotes the commentary of Lamar Williamson, she says this: "Glory refers to the majesty, radiance, and substantive weight of God's essential nature. That abundant to the brim, gallon upon gallon, really wonderful wine is indicative of God's nature. More wine than could ever be consumed points to the gifts of grace that come to us through Jesus Christ." And that's God's grace. It's this more than we could ever need abundance of blessings heaped on us. We're given gifts and skills that we can use to be the most wonderful people for God in this world. We're given blessings and families and friends and all these things in our lives that are provided for us so that we can do wonderful things with our life. Sometimes we are given great heaps of adversity so that we can come through, so that we can be stronger people as we're living our lives. All abundances of God's grace. I'm going to tell a story about God's grace, and I hope that it will tie everything together. Not just God's grace, but also that God is always with us, and that God gives us everything that we need as well. So this story is told by Charles Stanley, who's a Presbyterian minister, and it's told when he was in cemetery. Seminary was hard, but it wasn't that hard. It tells the story of when he was in seminary. He had a professor who gave a final exam that was very memorable. And the professor passed out the final exams, and he said, read it through before you start, and off you go. And of course, some people read the exam all the way through, and they found at some point near the end, it said, this exam is really hard. But if you want an A, sign your name right here on this piece of paper, turn it in, and you'll receive an A. And those that read it all through first sat there having it slowly dawn on them what this meant and what the professor was trying to do. However, there were some that didn't do this. There were some that started working right away, and they poured and sweated over this exam. They couldn't have studied enough for this exam. It was excruciatingly difficult, and no one could have passed it. And they sweated bullets all the way over till they got to the end, and they read it, and then their fears were relieved. And then they got that same gift of an A as those who read the exam. There were some that never knew that it existed. They answered the first 5 or 6 questions and were so frustrated, they turned in their test blank and they stormed out of the room, never knowing what was right there in front of them. And there was one person who took the exam, read it all the way through first, and decided that he didn't want that. He wanted to earn his grade. And he did. He got a C on the final exam. And so Charles Stanley says that he had since talked to the professor, and the professor had told him what the reactions were of different students over the years and explained how this does indeed point to God's grace. God's grace is there for us, and there's nothing we can do to earn it. It's just like signing your name. As hard as everything is, you sign your name on the test, you get an A on the final exam. As hard as everything is, God's grace is right there. All we have to do is accept it. Some people try to live without God's grace, and they sweat over bullets, and they pour over their life, and it doesn't make any sense. And then all of a sudden, they realize it's there, and all they have to do is accept it. Some never even realize or take the time to know that it's there. Living life the way it's supposed to be is too hard, it's too daunting, and they walk out of the room in disgust, never knowing that the grace is right there in front of them. And some like to earn that grace all on their own. They like to say, I can do it, I can earn it, this will make me a better person. But on their own, the best they can ever hope to accomplish with God is mediocrity, is a C. That is God's grace. That is God taking care of our every need. That is the presence of Christ with us every single day. It's right there. It's all we ever need. All we have to do is sign our name and accept it. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you, as we always thank you, for what you do for us in our lives. Give us the courage to live out your will each and every day. Amen.